from this family and one hakam from her family. Now these two hakam, if they want to create reconciliation or islah, or they want to set the things right, يوفق الله بينهما. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make a tawfiq, a reconciliation between two of them. There may be two meanings of this ayah. If these two judges want to set the things right, or if these two, husband and wife, they want to set the things right, يوفق الله بينهما. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them tawfiq. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them an ability to create this reconciliation. Both meanings can be taken here. Main thing is that those two people who are appointed by the elders, they are hakam. And when they are hakam or when they are judges, then their judgment is binding. You can't say, all right, these two arbiters have tried their best and now they have given one judgment, both of them mutually. And they are not accepting it. Husband and wife are not accepting it. Or two families are not accepting it. They say, oh, you are just two deputies or two solicitors from both parties. You have done your best. You have given your judgment, but it is not binding. What is the verse saying here? The verse is telling us that they are hakam. And when the word hakam is used, it means that they are qadi. They are the judges. So their judgment should be binding. This is the main thing which we should understand from this ayah, that before you go to any court, there is this institution of hakam, of judgment, which is to be taken from the members of the family themselves. If these two hakam, they are good people, they fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they come to a mutual agreement, then this agreement or this decision is binding. إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ عَلِيمًا خَبِيرًا. Indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows and He is well acquainted with all things. Again, now here these two attributes which I mentioned. عَلِيمًا خَبِيرًا. عَلِيم means who knows everything. خَبِير who is aware with everything. And in the preceding ayah, it was Ali and Kabir. Ali and Kabir was appropriate with the things which are mentioned there. And عَلِيمًا خَبِير is appropriate with the things which are mentioned here. These two hakam. Do they want Islah or they want Fasad? There may be two persons who want to make the things worse. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Alim, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Khabir, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what is in your heart. So don't try to spoil the things. Try to reconcile both parties. This is what your duty. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, in yurida islahan, if they wanted Islah, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them tawfiq. All right, if these two hakam, they don't agree upon something, they got difference of opinion, then of course, now you got no other way left except to go to the Muslim court, to a Muslim judge. And in the case of a woman, if she is asking for talaq, then she has to go to that Muslim court. Or, as you are living in a non-Muslim society, where there are no Muslim courts, to an authoritative body of the Muslims which decide in such matters. And as far as the man is concerned, the man is given the right to divorce. So if the man thinks that there is no way left except to divorce, then he can divorce. This is how this family matter should be decided. And I have to say with great pity that in this country we have seen so many cases of this nature. These matters are not taken into consideration. Very few times these arbitrary meetings are held. Mainly what happens that the man deserts the woman, or the woman leaves the home, and because this government is going to provide her with a separate house, she will go to a separate flat or house, and then there is no hope for reconciliation at all. But if we are Muslim, we should try to implement the teachings of Al-Qur'an. Now let us move to the next ayah. وَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا وبالوالدين إحسانا وبذي القربى واليتامى والمساكين والجار ذي القربى والجار الجنب والصاحب بالجنب وابن السبيل وما ملكت أيمانكم إن الله لا يحب من كان مختالا فخورا. Now that is a great ayah which combines a number of issues. First of all, it says وَعْبُدُ اللَّهِ and worship Allah. وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا and don't associate anything with him. وَعْبُدُ اللَّهِ, the word al-ibadah, which is used again and again in the Quran. عِبَادَةُ اللَّهِ, what means عِبَادَةُ اللَّهِ? عَبْد is the slave. So we become the real slaves of Allah. That is al-ibadah. If you are the slave of your master, then you got none of your will. You have to abide by the will of your master. That is the real ibadah. And as one definition is given, غَايَةُ الظُّلْ مَا غَايَةِ الْحُبِّ, the depth of humiliation which you show with a depth of love to your Creator. Because you may show humiliation, but you don't like your master. Like Bani Israel. Bani Israel were serving their masters, the pharaohs of Egypt, but they did not like them. Or you like the master, but you don't obey him. So there must be two things. You show your complete humility to your master, and also you love him because of his favors upon you. And that is none but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. His favors are so great to us that wherever we see the impression of his creation. Whatever he has created for us in this earth, whatever things we need for our life are provided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before our birth. Starting from our birth, starting with our parents who looked after us when we were tiny, when we were children, infants, till our deaths, we see all what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided for us. This shows that we have to love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And second thing, we have to worship alone. And this worship should be sincerely for him. أَلَا لِلَّهِ الدِّينُ الْخَالِصِ وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا and don't associate anything with him. So al-ibadah, our worship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should be done with complete sincerity. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَلَا لِلَّهِ الدِّينُ الْخَالِصِ, beware, to Allah belongs the sincere deen, the sincere obedience. It means that you don't make any association with that in that worship at all. If you do that, then this is the real worship. But when you start worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you say, oh, some of this devotion is for Allah, huh? And some of the devotion is for the people, to show them that you are praying very nicely and this and that. If your intention is to please the human beings as well, so it is not khalis. Khalis means sincere to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Completely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it is not khalis. Yani people, some of ulama have said that even when you make wudu, your intention should be that I am doing this wudu for the sake of Allah, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted me to do wudu before prayer, so this is why I am doing this wudu. But if your intention is but that by this wudu, if it is a hot day, I will get some cold as well, I will have some coolness as well. So then this intention is not pure for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the same way, when you fast, you say fasting is for Allah, but it is also good for health. So it means that it is not purely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala needs pure worship for Him. This is why first shirk, the major shirk is that you share in the forms of worship any deity. That is the major shirk which is not forgivable. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not going to forgive it. Inna Allah yaghfiru dhunuba jami'a wa la yaghfiru an yushraka bih. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can forgive all the sins except this sin, that you share someone with him. That is the major shirk. At the time of the revelation of the Quran, this major shirk was known in the forms of idols. Idols, people used to have idols, and they say, oh, these idols, though they create them with their own hands, but they said that they are just the exposition of different deities. So that was major shirk. This type of shirk is still known. For example, in India, in Japan, in Far East countries, this type of shirk is known. Among the Christians, this type of shirk is known, which is directed to Jesus Christ. Among the Muslims, this type of shirk is also known. How? When they think that your dua, your supplications are not accepted until you travel to a certain grave of a certain saint. Now those people who go to such graves, they don't say that we worship this grave, they don't say. I very clearly say to you, they don't say that we worship this grave, no. They say that is a dead person, he is a saint, and he is beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We only go there, why? Because of the barakah, the blessing of the saint, our supplications are more responded. And this is how they commit this type of shirk. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very near to you. He responds to you, it depends upon your own state of mind. If you are in such a position that you are known to be mustar. Mustar means that you got no way out for you at all. And then you turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, oh Allah, I am in great hardship, oh Allah help me. That is the point when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helps you. But apart from that, you know, this is the one which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that I am going to help that person or to respond to that person. But in other cases he has given us that there are some times when dua is more responded. There are some places where dua is more responded. As far as the timing is concerned, he has given this timing. Different timing after fasting, at the time of breakfast, for example. On Friday, there is a time whenever a person supplicates to Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds to him. After the prayers, after any good actions. So these are the timing. The places are also given. The houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the mosques. In the same way, when you go for Hajj, Al-Kaaba and Safa and Marwa and Arafat and then Muzdalifah, Al-Mashar Al-Haram, all these places, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, they are sacred places and your dua is responded. So if you think about such times and places, these are given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Apart from that, from your own mind you say, no, if I go to such and such grave, and then I supplicate there, my dua would be responded, then this is not sincerely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You think that because you have traveled to such and such place, and because you are standing by the side of that that grave, this is why your dua is responded. It is no more sincere to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is an element of shirk here as well. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala demands from us, وَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا, and worship Allah and don't make any association with Him at all. So this is the major one. After that there is one which is known as hidden shirk, الشرك الخفي. And what is الشرك الخفي? Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has given the example, a person prays and he tried to make his prayer longer or beautiful. Why? Just to show the people. Because he thinks that people are sitting around and they are looking at his prayer, so let me make my prayer more beautiful. This is ashirk al-khafi, or the hidden shirk by which your prayer becomes invalid. So see that a man is praying for Allah at that time. He is standing towards Qibla. He is reading Surah Al-Fatiha, but only because he got this thought in his mind that let the people be pleased with my prayer, it becomes shirk. Let alone Going to the grave of a saint and then supplicating there? That thing becomes greater. Or we can say, yani, very simply to understand this issue, that as far as worship is concerned, all the forms of worship which are given to us in the prayer, in Hajj, these forms of prayer should only be directed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not to anybody else. In the prayer, when you say Allahu Akbar and you stand in a certain way, by putting one right hand on your left hand, facing towards Qibla, it means that this type of posture is only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You don't do it for any human being. If you do it, then it would be a shirk. In the same way, you go to ruku, you bow down only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you do it for anybody else, that would be a shirk. When you do sajda and you place your forehead on the ground, that is only for Allah, you can't do it for any human being. In the same way, when you go around 7 times, around Kaaba, this type of worship is only done around Kaaba. There is no other place throughout the world where you can do such practice. And if you do that, that would be shirk. In the same way, there are no 2 points in the world where we have to go 7 times like Safa and Marwa. So all these forms of worship which are given to us, that is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you direct them to someone else, that would be shirk. You got respect for your teacher? Yes. How to show this respect? All right. There are so many ways to show respect to your teacher. You sit quietly in front of him. Huh? You don't raise voice upon his voice. If he commands you to do something, you do it. But apart from that, you try to kiss his hand, to kiss his feet, to kiss his elbow. That is not the way you should respect your teacher. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said that when you meet your brother, when you are meeting your brother ordinarily, you shake hand with him, with your right hand, not with your two hand. No, this practice, remember, two hands practice, that is not the Islamic practice. One hand, right hand. All right, after traveling, when you come, you meet your brother, you embrace him. That is known as mu'anaka, that is all right. And also, to kiss on the forehead for the elders, that is also, it was known in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, sahaba have done it, that is all right as well. Now apart from that, other practices which some people who claims to be knowledgeable people, people with knowledge and people who think that they are guiding other people, they must not allow their disciple to do such things. Start even going in the shape of ruku to bow down in front of them, or to prostrate in front of them, or to kiss their hand at feet. All these things were not practiced by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we should try to abstain from it. Because some of these practices may not be shirk, but they are showing honor, respect, which even Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not demand from his disciples. So that is a shirk al-khafi and shirk which can be done in any way when we direct the forms of worship which is only for Allah to someone else other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. Now whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioned sometime in Quran, the second thing to be mentioned is to do good to your parents, showing that after the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the greatest right which is given to any human being are your parents. So be nice to them. وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. وَقَالَ رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّاهُ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decided that you must not worship except Him and do ihsan and treat your parents nicely. Again, the very same thing is mentioned here. After the right of Allah, the right of the parents. Because parents are the cause of your presence in this world. Because of your parents, you are here in this world. They have taken care for you when you were young. Now take care for them when they are old. But it says, وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. Do good to your parents. It does not say, وَعْبُدُ الْوَالِدَيْنِ. And worship your parents. No, it does not say like that. Worshipping is only for Allah. As far as parents are concerned, you have to do good to them, to be nice to them. If they ask you something which is un-Islamic, if they ask you to do something which is shirk, then you have not to listen to them. Again, the same ihsan are good deeds, or nice treatment should be given to some other people as well. وَبِذِ الْقُرْبَىٰ. Those people who are relative, also treat them nicely. وَالْيَتَامَىٰ. Orphans. والمساكين, the poor people, are those people who are in need. والجار ذي القربى والجار الجنب. Neighbors, two types of neighbor. The neighbor who is your relative, that is والجار ذي القربى. والجار الجنب, and the neighbor who is not your relative, who is a stranger one. But as far as he is a jar, he is a neighbor, then he got some right upon you. There is one hadith, though there is a weakness in its isnad, the meaning seemed to be right, that there are some neighbors who got three rights, some who got two rights, some who got only one right. The neighbor who got three rights, who is a Muslim, then he is your neighbor, and then he is your relative as well. So because of these three things, he got three rights upon you. The one who got two rights, the Muslim neighbor only. He is not your relative, but he is a Muslim neighbor. And the third one, a kafir neighbor. He is not a Muslim, but he is still your neighbor. So the neighbor got such a great right upon you that Prophet ﷺ said, مَا زَالَ جِبْرِيلُ يُوسِينِ بِالْجَارِ حَتَّى زَنَنْتُ أَنَّهُ سَيُوَرِّسُنِي. Jibreel, our Prophet is saying, Jibreel started giving me nasiha or wasiya about the neighbor until I thought that he is going to make him my inheritor. Yani Jibreel said to me so much things about the neighbor that I thought that in the end he would say, oh, after your death he would inherit you as well. That is the right of the neighbor. In another hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said, لا يؤمن أحدكم. The one of you does not become a believer. He said it three times. He does not become a believer. He does not become a believer. And then this, the Sahaba Ikram asked, who is that person? And the Prophet said, حتى يأمن جاره بوائقه. Until his neighbor is saved from his bad thing or from his mistreatment. Then you must not mistreat your neighbor. You must be very good to him. It is also said that if you cook something and you think that your neighbor is smelling that cooking, you must present him some of that food. You must give him as a present. Let alone if he does not smell it, even then it is good if you gift him something of your food. And again, the Prophet ﷺ also said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala becomes very angry to that person whose neighbor sleeps at night without eating. So the person should be very careful whether if his neighbor is a poor person, that he should be fed. And also Prophet ﷺ said to his wives, لَا تَحْقِرَنَّ جَارَةٌ جَارَتَهَا وَلَوْ بِفِرْسٍ شَاتٍ. No neighbor should despise among the women. No neighbor should despise her neighbor, even if you have to gift a little flesh of the sheep which you have cooked. Yani you must not say, oh Allah, I got a very, very small piece of flesh. How should I gift it to my neighbor? No, you can gift it. It's all right. What is the limit of the neighborhood? According to some hadith, 40 houses around you. 40 houses this way, 40 houses that way, that would be something very great. Some other said, all right, those people, yani if azan is done, those people who listen to azan, yani, or you say, you can say that if you got a mosque in your locality, all those people who listen to azan, they are your neighbor. And the third saying is that all the people living in that locality, they are your neighbor. So you would be very careful that even if you want to do some repair work in your house, in the wall which is shared by you and your neighbor, you must not do something which is going to harm your neighbor, or at least take his permission. So now these are the two types of neighbor, wal-jari zul-qurba, wal-jari al-junub. The neighbor who is your relative and the neighbor who is the stranger. Treat them nicely. And the third one here was sahibi bil jamb, and the company by your side. When you are traveling, so the person who is sitting at your side, he becomes now your sahib, your company. So treat him nicely. And alhamdulillah, this is a very good Muslim practice. Whenever they ride in the train, for example, in the bus, someone wants to eat something and he is going to offer it to the next person or to the people around him. That is something good, which is only found among the Muslims. As far as non-Muslims are concerned, we did not see such things among them. They will open their food box and they start eating it, whether you like it or not. But alhamdulillah, that is a Muslim practice and it's a very good practice. وَالصَّحَبِ بِالْجَمْ, let alone to harm your company who is sitting next to you. Because some people, they, when, for example, if the seats are very narrow, one is taking more space, so harming the other person, he must remember that he is his company. So he should show some humility and kindness to his company. The next one in this list is Wabnus Sabil, and those people who are traveling, treat them nicely as well. If a traveler comes to you and asks you assistance, give him that assistance. He may be a very rich person at home, but now during traveling he might have lost his belongings and he wants your assistance, so please help him. وَمَا مَلَكَتْ أَيْمَانُكُمْ, and what your right hand possess. It means the captives, the slaves. And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said very clearly that time when slaves were found in the Muslim society, that treat them as you treat your own brothers and sisters. Feed them what you eat yourself. Give them for clothing what you dress by yourself. And don't ask them to do hard jobs. And then Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also said that if a person beats his slave, a severe beating, then its expiation is to set him free. This is how that person can get his expiation. وَمَا مَلَكَتْ أَيْمَانُكُمْ. So though slavery was allowed in Islam, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given such a great favor to the slaves, that because of that good treatment, many, many slaves in the Muslim society became Muslim by their own accord. And the people used to set them free. You know the history of Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala. Even before Islam, he used to buy them and free them. And the last part of this ayah, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ مَنْ كَانَ مُحْتَالًا فَخُورًا. And Allah loves not those people who are arrogant, the vain, glorious. مُحْتَال, the translation is given, the one who is arrogant, yani who is always in the habit of looking to himself. Oh, how nice I am. How nice is my clothes. How beautiful are my shoulders and my appearance. Every time he is looking about himself. That is mukhtal. And again, in his even in his walking, he seems to be very arrogant. He does not show humility at all. Fakhura, and he is always in his pride. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not like such type of qualities. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala likes from the people is to show humility to other people. Man tawada'a lillah rafa'ahu Allah. If you show humility for the sake of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will raise you. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is walking in the street. An old woman comes, holds his hand for quite a long time, and Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is listening to her. He is not saying, oh, I got no time, leave me alone. No. Though he is busy, but he is still talking to her. That is the real humility. If someone is asking help from you, try to give that help to